Good morning. It's good to be with all of you. I encourage you to take a seat for a few announcements before we begin. And I want to start by acknowledging the weekend. I hope you're having a great holiday weekend, but also please take a moment when we pray together and in your own prayers to be mindful of all those who gave that greatest sacrifice for our freedoms, the freedom to be here and worship today, the freedoms we enjoy this holiday weekend. But certainly remember the occasion that we are celebrating. In the life of the church, this is a week in which we start a lot of our renovation projects. We've been waiting a long time to get started, and it will start Tuesday, but that will mean relative chaos over the next several weeks. Please call ahead before you get in your car and head over here as they're starting with the ramp and the bathrooms and down below. So a lot of our facilities will be closed or at least in limited capacity. But that's a sign of progress. So absolutely. And a few other things this summer. I want you to discern whether you might be called to our Education for Ministry program. It's a four-year program, and there's four spots. It really is a wonderful way to deepen your faith and your understanding. Please read about that. And our formation over this season will be about why we worship the way we do. Most of our traditions go back hundreds, if not thousands of years, but why do we do the things that we do? It's peculiar if you come in off the streets for the first time to come in and experience our worship, but each movement of our liturgy has a purpose that liturgists and theologians have wrestled over the centuries. So both Randolph and I will be leading these discussions on why we do the things we do in worship and what they mean to us. Also, I encourage you to keep that date, June 9th, marked on your calendar. We are very proud of Selden in his graduation from seminary and his acceptance of a new position as the priest associate at Christ Church Alexandria and youth minister. And we would love to be there in droves to support him during his ordination on June 9th. If you are driving and you have extra space, let us know that. Or if you'd love to grab a ride with somebody, let us know that as well. And I encourage you to take a look at the back of the insert because there's lots of ways that you can get involved. We encourage you to take a look, whether locally or around the globe, there's wonderful ways to get involved here at St. James, and we encourage you to do so. Mm-hmm. And now let's take a deep breath and gather and stand for worship.
Thank you.
top line, but we are no longer in the Easter season, so our opening sentence is, "Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit."
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forevermore.
Let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you the secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
A reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed, and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read Psalm 29 responsively by whole verse. Ascribe to the Lord, you gods. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord glory to his name. Worship the Lord, you gods.
cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon.
He makes Lebanon shake like a cataract, and the
The voice of the Lord splits the flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh.
The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees around me, and shakes the forest
there.
And in the temple of the Lord, all are crying glory.
The Lord sits enthroned above the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as king forevermore.
The Lord shall give strength to his people. The Lord shall give his people the blessing of peace.
A reading from Romans. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in effect we suffer from him, so that we may also be glorified with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? Jesus answered him, are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen. Yet do you not receive our testimony? And if I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. So this is the only Sunday of the church year dedicated to a doctrine of the church. And it's not a cuddly or transformative doctrine in and of itself. In fact, it seems kind of like a middle school math problem that that has you scratching your head for hours. 1 + 1 + 1 = 1, and you're convinced that it doesn't work out that way. In fact, it was an early attempt to explain that we are very much and clearly a monotheistic religion, even though we have God in three persons, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the creator of all things, the revelation of God incarnate, and the God that continues to move through our lives, the Holy Spirit. And so we use words like three persons but one substance, or the idea of a dance, of a rotation of God in relationship with God's self. You're still not getting fluttery in your heart yet, are you? It really is difficult, and we use analogies to try to make it make sense. We talk about H2O and how if I had a glass of water, it was very much water, and if I stuck it in the freezer for an hour or two, it would still be water even though it's frozen, and then if I let it sit out for several days and it evaporated, it would still have the same properties. We use the image of an apple, that the skin on the outside is very much apple. If you ask what it was, you'd say apple, and that meaty flesh is indeed part of the apple, as is the core. And we keep going on in this circular way, or the fact that I am Father Ben to some, I am Dad to others, I am a husband to one particular person, but I'm still one person. We use all of these analogies to wrap our mind around the Trinity, but what I want to talk to you about is not so much the technical aspects of the Trinity, but what it means holistically. One way to start thinking about it is to think about it in the context of our liturgical year. We are about halfway through the year. In fact, Bishop Shannon talked about the year in two parts, that we start in Advent and we run through the season till this particular Sunday, and this is a pivot point. And it is the story of God's relentless, absolutely relentless pursuit of us. From the preparation for that Christ child to be born, God coming into the world, those first epiphany experiences of people encountering the living God, the love that was poured out upon the cross, The love that had so much power that even death could not contain it. Those Easter experiences, those resurrection stories of people encountering the living God and realizing that nothing could separate them from the love of God, that it still pursued them even after the other side of death into new life. And then that gift of the Holy Spirit we celebrated last week, that God has been on a tear for us since the very beginning of our liturgical year until now. And this is the summation of all of it. The God who is so robust, we have to come up with some large contraption or large bucket to fit God into that even that can't contain. And so we come up with the idea of the Trinity. And then we spend the second half of the year, that green growing season, responding to this God that has been relentless in God's pursuit of us. And so that's where we are at this pivot point in our life in the church. And I think we need to think about the Trinity in terms of the nature of God that is anything but static, anything but flat, but is constantly in movement towards us and isn't safe. This is an interesting image that sits with me. If you've ever been interested in the C.S. Lewis, The Chronicles of Narnia, the Christ figure is the lion, Aslan. And the boy is intrigued, but reasonably cautious and anxious about approaching this God figure, Aslan. And he asks, is he safe? Is he safe? And the response is, oh, no, boy. He's not safe. He's certainly not safe. But he's good. But he's good. God doesn't promise to be safe or to allow us to remain safe when we've encountered the living God. But God is indeed good, and God is indeed loving, and God is indeed moving towards us in relationship with us. And I think this gospel story is one of the most beautiful examples of that, of what God calls us to and about the nature of God. So Nicodemus is a religious leader. He makes his living by being a leader in the church, and he's found a comfortable position, negotiated nicely with Rome as a leader in his church community. He has status, he has a healthy living, and he has the assurance of knowing that he understands God, and that God has flattened nicely into his pocket so that he can enjoy the comforts of what he has been afforded in the church and in the culture of the time. But something doesn't square with him. Something is gnawing at him. Something tells him that there's more to this God than adherence to these particular laws. That the way that he has been taught to convey God to the world, unless we think this is of a particular religion, each religion has tried to flatten God over time, has tried to make God conveniently fit into their back pocket so they can go about the way of life that they want, that they can live conveniently. And I think it's a question that we should all ask ourselves. Are we trying to fit God into our pocket now and in this day? But something is gnawing so fully at Nicodemus that he's willing to risk, but not everything yet. In fact, I think he goes to see Jesus in the dark of night, hoping that he realizes this is all just smoke and mirrors, that he can discredit it, that he can go back to the comfortable, safe God that he's in charge of. And so he goes in the dark of night, and he visits Jesus, and Jesus says, you've been trying to fit God into your pocket. You've been trying to flatten God so that God fits into the order that you've conceived, but the true task of being a follower of God is not fitting God into you, but jumping into God, being baptized from above, giving your life into God, not taking God along on your life's journey. And it gnaws on him. And he asks a whole bunch of questions, and the conversation is somewhat circular, and he walks away, and we're not quite sure whether this was just enough gibberish for him to be able to wash his hands of it and say, you know what, I gave it a whirl, but I'm going to go back to my way of being, or whether he's still being transformed by it. And in one of the beautiful Easter stories that takes place between the cross and the empty tomb is Nicodemus' Easter story. Mm-hmm. Nicodemus puts everything on the line. He He dives into a God who is anything but safe. And he says, you know what? I'll help pay for the funeral costs. Let me take this man off the cross. Let me pay to have him wrapped and prepared for burial. And in doing so, we start to see that something transformed in him, that the encounter with the living God left him changed and moved to a new place. When we meet the Trinity, we meet a God who is in relentless pursuit of us, a God who would do anything for us, but a God who calls us not just to flatten God and fit him in our pocket so that we can go about feeling blessed in the way that we live our lives, but a God who deeply wants us to jump in to that wonderful, loving relationship that God has with God's self. And God deeply yearns for us. So the question is, we see how Nicodemus' Easter story ends. How's our story going to end? Are we willing to leap into that triune, abundant God and watch our lives transformed in anything but safety? Amen. I invite you to stand and face the cross as we affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with Scripture. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers of the people are found in your bulletin. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. Michael, our presiding bishop, Shannon, Susan, and Bob, our bishops, Ben and Randolph, our clergy, Sidonie, rector of our companion church and school, and Selden, our seminarian. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. We pray especially for St. James Episcopal Church and School, our Stephen ministers and their care receivers, and the people of St. Luke's True du Nord Haiti, our companion church and school, and our new journey together. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble, especially for Peter, Griffin, Liz, Noreen, Carrie, Anne, Beatty, Laura, Melba, Carol, Marissa, and Marie, for our military, especially for Hunter, Mark, Warren, Madeline Blodgett, Helen Emery, Todd, James, Tom Spector, their families, and all deployed in harm's way. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. We give thanks for our many blessings, which we now name either silently or aloud.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Please be seated. Being it's a holiday weekend and Randolph is away, we will just be using the main altar today, and all are welcome to come to the Lord's table. Remember that you can receive in bread and in wine, or if you need a gluten-free wafer, make that known as well, or if you prefer a blessing, just come forward with your arms crossed. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For with your co-eternal Son and Holy Spirit, you are one God, one Lord, in trinity of persons and in unity of being. And we celebrate the one and equal glory of you, O Father, and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. Night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And that the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us eat and feast. Alleluia.
Thank you.
gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. You have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless and keep you.
Amen.
The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you.
Amen.
The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.
The Lord God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the holy and undivided Trinity, guard you, save you, and bring you to that heavenly city where he lives and reigns forever and ever.